David, I can't believe you didn't check to see if this truck or store had patrol. You call this a getaway? This is more like a stuckaway.
Hey, I had to plan this entire mission to break into this Nazi bike's peanut butter factory just because you had a peanut butter craving. Hello, some appreciation.
Oh God. Okay. I'm sorry. I was PMSing. You know what happens if I don't get my peanut fix.
Don't even get me started.
Hey, can you imagine if I was constantly in depressed mode? I wouldn't be able to host this show, Tomboy T-Rod, Asia's biggest and only all-female English comedy chat podcast.
Yeah, I guess so. After all, they are a no-holds-barred fortnightly podcast with a whole lot of geek, drama, and humor thrown into every episode.
Yeah, and we don't pronounce it Tomboy T-Raid or Tomboy Ty-Raid. We like to say it the way we like to say it, like Tomboy T-Rod. Great peanut pickly teeth! What in Elman's arse was that?
Cassis! I saw a shadow in the distance!
Shit! That's it. We're fucked. Quick, we need to make an exit right now, or it's the slammer for us. Out of the truck now!
Roger that!
Hey, shh. This way. Make sure we're not seen.
Damn it! It's too dark! I can't even see a ghost!
Oh, that's because you are one. Come on, shh. Let's head down. I think I see a lighted corridor ahead. Let's head over there.
Oh no! Not so fast!
Yeah. Not so fast, whoever you are. Good ninja move there, Raven. Excellent troubleshooting.
Thanks! Okay, spill!
Spill this!
Your head down.
This is one huge peanut butter factory.
I know, right? I'm in like heaven. Well, right up till she showed up.
I know. Oh, look, a room. Let's get in there and regroup.
Great idea. Let's go in.
The Wonder Twins, with their recycled bag full of nutty bites.
Hey, shut up before we pull a ninja on you. Who are you and, like, what are you doing here?
Yeah!
I'm Nuke Chess. But people call me Nutty. Along with Tech, my co-host of the Nutty Bites Geek Podcast, we are also the owners of this peanut butter factory. I'm an artist by day, blogger and podcaster by night. And I'm also the chief editor and director of Nimlast.org and Nimlast Studios.
Oh, where's your partner? Where's Tech?
He's away on a mission, a secret mission. And he's a real-life weapons technician, hence the explosive smoke bomb you just experienced. He also takes care of the security at this factory, so watch out. This place is fortified like Castle Black.
Wait, didn't the Castle Black suffer from a crushing defeat by the White Walkers and Wildlings recently?
Oh, shut up, Raven. Save your comments. Wow. Hey, you know what? That's like bringing some serious balls to the show, and we like that. So, but the only thing is, just don't self-destruct the show after 5 seconds, okay? Oh, I'm still suffering from, like, you know, lung cancer from the smoke bomb. Ugh.
Cool. Are you guys on social media too?
We're very social. You can find me on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Tumblr, all of it at NukeChess. Yeah, have fun spelling that. But you can find the links at nimlast.org. And Tech? Oh yeah, he's on Twitter. Just look for @theclockdoc separated by underscores. And he's also on Facebook.
Nice. Cool. We'll check it out.
So, what are you guys doing here at our factory so late at night, eh?
Well, Well, you know what? We're your night shift truck drivers. Yeah, yeah, that's what it is.
We don't have any night shift truck drivers.
Yeah, we know. We are called in to deliver some last minute orders for one of your clients.
Yeah, here, from your list here. See?
Yeah, he put in his order really late, so, and we're about to make that delivery, but the truck ran out of gas, so...
Okay. We should have some extra fuel lying around somewhere, but it's going to be quite a walk to storage.
Yeah, I know. Figures, this place is pretty huge.
Like Willy Wonka's chocolate factory.
Well, almost. We don't always kill children here.
Could have fooled me with that smoke bomb just now.
I know, tell me about it.
Okay, kids, ready? There's a few interesting places in this factory I want you guys to see as well.
Great! Well, lead the way. We can talk about some geeky stuff as we walk. Like the highly anticipated news revolving around the 2017 Spider-Man movie. And some smartwatch wars going on in Barcelona. What's up with that? As well as more interesting stuff, right?
Yeah, off of Black Season 3.
Yeah.
And a Nutty Bites inspired quiz.
Yeah.
A Nutty Bites quiz? I'm game. Come on, let's go.
Yeah! Oh, yeah! All right.
It's been rebooted, restarted, recycled, regurgitated, ridiculous, if you ask me. You can call it whatever you want, but I'm pretty sure there are two factions reacting to this news right about now, that Drew Goddard, director of Cabin in the Woods and World War Z, is set to direct the next reboot of the Spider-Man movies.
Latina Review first dropped the news that Cabin in the Woods writer and director Drew Goddard is currently in talks to helm and pen the screenplay for Spider-Man's 2017 outing. As we told you previously, Sony and Marvel have reached a deal to have Spider-Man join the MCU, with the character set to be introduced in an upcoming Marvel movie, most likely next year's Captain America Civil War. That will be followed by a new Spider-Man film set to hit theaters on July 28, 2017, that will be produced by Marvel and released by Sony. According to Latino Review, the new film will be called The Spectacular Spider-Man and will not be an origin story, but will follow Peter Parker in high school with hopes for the character to grow into the role.
Oh man, not again. Why are we doing this?
I felt like I'm moving back in time. It's like this never-ending show. It's like, how many ridiculous reboots or what comic superhero can they make? And it's the same Peter Parker over and over and over and over and over again. And now there's what? Robert Downey Jr. in it. What?
The first film will reportedly include Robert Downey Jr. as Iron Man, with the pair battling as a sort of audition to see if he is worthy of joining the ranks of the Avengers. Just last week, Robert Downey Jr. teased a big ol' Marvel announcement would be happening this week, and some are speculating that it could involve his inclusion in the 2017 Spider-Man movie.
We've had like 5 Spider-Man movies already, right? In the last 10 years, I think. Am I right? And it's, I feel like it's all gotten a bit too much for me. I feel like it's been rebooted in so many times.
So did we have to start all over with a new actor? No, let's move
Carry
it forward.
On,
go
right?
into
yeah.
the future of Peter Parker's life. Just don't get so invested in these actors, you know? It's not about the actor, it's about the story.
But it is. You get the feeling that they're so invested in the actor that now you feel that as an audience, you feel like you are actually a victim in an actual spider web, because I feel like I'm caught in a spider web with Spider-Man, because I don't really know where they're going with him.
Yeah, why can't they do like a Flash or a Gotham? Would that be more interesting?
Well, they could make more Spider-Man movies, but why do we have to see Spider-Man's origin story every time?
Yeah.
It's my same complaint
Thank
about
you.
Batman movies. Why do we all know that Bruce's parents are dead. Can we jump into Batman in the middle? Peter Parker has been Spider-Man for so long, and it's not always Peter Parker either. There's so many stories to tell. Why do we have to see Uncle Ben die all the time?
Yeah. How many times have he died? You know? I can't even remember.
And the same thing with Peter Parker. How many times are we going to see the fact that he got bit by a spider? La 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 la. And, you know, one time he's like in his 30s, and then after that he's in his early 20s, and then I don't know. They might as well just make a teen version of Spider-Man. Come on, let's have it, you know? And I don't want to say this, but I think sometimes it's the studio's fault. Because if you've got a studio like Warner Brothers or Sony Pictures, who don't have a clear idea of Sony. The direction in which they're bringing a comic book character, then you're going to see a lot of the characterization suffer. I think you're going to see that, for example, like if you put the Batman movies and the Spider-Man movies against what they're doing now with the Marvel comic book heroes, you can really tell, and we've spoken about this before, how Marvel has had a 20-year plan for these movies, right? So you can tell that they really sat down and they really thought about, okay, this is what we're going to do for the 10-year plan, and this is what we're going to do in 20 years.
Yeah, and there's so many good stories. Yeah. I started reading Spider-Man when he was already married. And one of the things that I loved about Spider-Man was his relationship with Mary Jane. This was a superhero who was married, and she knew what he did, and she was supportive, and they had this great relationship, and it was so different from any other comic book I had ever read. Then you bring it to the movies, and it's teen angst with Peter and Gwen, or Peter and Mary Jane, and it's not what I fell in love with.
It's a shame about the past two Spider-Man movies. I felt not that just a waste of time. I thought they actually did a pretty decent job in the casting.
Yeah, I actually liked Andrew Garfield as Spider-Man.
I do. And I thought they will continue with the story.
And I think that Emma Stone...
Because they are a couple in real life, so they had the chemistry. And
I didn't know that.
But when they announced the casting, I thought they were going to go on with the, you know, the whole marriage story. But they never did, which is a waste, because they have so much chemistry, they are so good together, and it will have been perfect, you know, she will have made the perfect Mary Jane.
Yeah.
But instead, they had to reboot.
Yeah, but they cast her as Gwen Stacy, who's supposed to die.
That's right.
But I love Emma Stone. I think she's a fantastic actress. I didn't know that she and Andrew Garfield were an item, so I didn't even know that. And I've only seen the first one. I'm still waiting to see the second one. But I actually really enjoyed it.
Don't bother.
Avoid it?
No.
Okay. But that's the other thing. Like, I liked the first Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movie. And it just got sadder as it went on. And
yeah, he was perfect at that period of time when he was an angsty teen. And you would expect them to move on, like, you know, because Spider-Man evolved from a teenage superhero to an adult story. But you don't get it in the movies. It's like, he's forever a teenager. Peter Parker is more than that.
He's one of the only characters that actually grows up.
Yeah.
And they didn't do that in the movies.
I really hope they do a different interpretation. They have to bring somebody else to the picture. I mean, we have a new Spider-Man. We have the Hispanic Spider-Man.
Oh, I didn't know that.
In the comics, do you have a new Spider-Man?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, yes. And I hope they really take out his story. Because I'm very, very sick of Peter Parker, and I felt that Andrew Garfield was really screwed over big time. And he is so good, but they just like tossing him out the window, and we're going to start again with another teenage Spider-Man.
Well, I had read that Andrew Garfield didn't want to do a third movie.
Yeah.
And that was part of the issue, is that he was done with Spider-Man, which is good. I'd much rather him get out of it ahead of time than be stuck like Tobey Maguire was. And the other thing is, they're going to have to do, or they should be doing, a Spider-Man story that's around the age that he was during Civil War.
Yeah.
Because that's the only reason I can imagine that this deal is going on, is that Spider-Man's part of Civil War. So hopefully, you know, it's not going to be a young Peter Parker, because otherwise, why would Tony Stark care?
Tony Stark would not give a damn, you know that, yeah.
Yeah, he wouldn't give a shit.
But what would be interesting is to have a Spider-Man speak completely in Spanish throughout the Avengers movie, And we could just subtitle him in that part. That's it. Okay, everyone. Piñatas out.
I totally would see like Clint being able to speak Spanish with him. I think that Red Widow would also be able to speak Spanish. I'm pretty sure Pepper Potts can speak Spanish. Yeah. Let's see, who else? Thor, no.
Yeah. Thor is a Viking, no. So there's no way.
Yeah, he can.
Oh, and we already know that Bruce Banner can because he's hidden in some Spanish-speaking countries.
Yeah.
Or better still, they could bring in the Indian Spider-Man because Bruce Banner was in India for a while there, right? So we could have a completely Bollywood version of this movie.
Okay, we're here at one of the strange rooms we were talking about. It's called the Rain Room.
Oh, wow! Look, horses! It's raining peanuts!
Yeah, I know. Holy cannoli! So it is. How do you guys do it? This is so cool.
It's a very special process. We do this to get the peanuts ready for the smashing and the grinding process. By raining and splattering the peanuts on the floor, they become easier for the grinding process.
Nice. Wow. Boy, you guys have this whole peanut butter thing down to a science, don't you? Are you offering timeshares by any chance?
Shout out, Persis. We have to go and look for fewer and down to our next news highlight, which is a recent smartwatch wars with Apple that kicked off at the Mobile World Congress at Barcelona recently.
There's a lot of buzz at this year's Mobile World Congress focused on the smartwatch sector, with many of the device makers keeping a firm eye on that March the 9th date when Apple is expected to launch its first smartwatch. The big question is, can any of the device makers here really compete? Chinese mobile giant Huawei caused quite a stir when it released its Huawei Watch at the start of the Mobile World Congress. And here it is. It's very much combining fashion and technology. It's got a genuine leather strap, which you don't see on many smartwatches. It's got a nice, smooth interface here. It uses Google's Android Wear operating system. It's got a six-axis sensor, and it's got a heart rate monitor on the back. So this is LG's newly launched Urbane LTE smartwatch. It's got an antenna built into the strap, which means that it acts as a phone. You don't have to have your smartphone on you. It's also got NFC technology, so you can make payments with this in cafes and bars. Got lots of apps, including health and fitness tracking. It's going to launch in South Korea in 2 months, and we're still waiting for a date for the European or global launch as well. And smartwatches do really take off in a big way. The Swiss have thrown their hats into the ring with this. It's the Mychronos Z Phone. It packs in a SIM card, so it's basically a phone and a watch combined. And it uses Android's operating system, so you've got all your apps as well. Very different from usual Swiss heritage watches.
Yeah, what was up with that? I mean, like, I already have a smartwatch that tells me the time. I mean, how smart can a watch get? I mean, Mobile World Congress was like this huge big deal. Everyone that was anyone in tech was there. And what was so funny was that everyone's been talking about Apple releasing this new iWatch, right, the last few months. I think ever since it was revealed in WWDC last year. But now it's like Huawei, this brand from China that produces smartphones, cheap smartphones, they actually, you know, shook up the whole Mobile World Congress audience when they actually revealed their new smartwatch. So I'm like, wow. And what do you guys think about the whole smartwatch movement in the first place?
Well, I haven't worn a watch since I had a beeper back in 96, so... Very rarely do I wear watches these days. Tech is a big fan of watches, but of course they have to be mechanical ones, the automatic. None of its quartz stuff, nothing with a battery. He likes the ones that wind themselves as you walk. For me, when I heard about the Apple Watch coming out back in the fall, I said to myself, I said, if it's going to be something, it has to be game-changing. The way that the iPhone changed how we look at cell phones and made it the thing to have. And when they came out with this smartwatch, it was too expensive. And it really was just like a controller for your phone because it didn't work independently, really. Yeah. Like you still, it still had to be within range of your phone and it didn't do much. So it was kind of a dud. So it's exciting to see somebody else come out there. And I'm assuming that it's going to be much cheaper because they make cheaper phones. And so maybe it'll actually make watches relevant again. But it still has to do something where it's game changing. I don't know all the specifics. You know, can I use this watch without my phone?
Yeah, and you're right, because it's completely synced up with your phone, and it does the same, pretty much the same things as what a phone already has, right? Like, I mean, like taking your pulse, you know, you can run with it, you can exercise to it, and you can probably hook it up to tell you the time, the weather, and all that kind of good stuff. But what really got to me, and I agree with this article, that Ben Norton was actually the watch designer for this new Huawei watch, and he came up with this really interesting point about how when he first started designing these smartphones, he wanted to design something that looked very much like a traditional watch, because we just want a watch that looks like a watch. You know, seriously, the Apple Watch, or the prototype that we've been seeing so far from Google and Apple and Samsung, it just feels very cheap. Yeah. It feels very plastic. I mean,
it looks like a kid's watch, whereas this one looks like a mechanical watch, only illuminated.
That's right, like a Swiss watch, like a proper watch, right? And I get his point, and I totally agree, because, I mean, yeah, it could be the coolest watch, but I wouldn't even go near an iWatch because it just looks so cheap. And I don't wear watches particularly just for, you know, I wear it because sometimes it matches my clothes, you know, it looks good on my clothes, you know? I mean,
it's an accessory.
It's an accessory, and it always has to be one, right?
But I always find it that watches being an issue, like smartwatch. There's this thing they didn't address in all the smartwatches. Because I have very bad eyesight. I can't really see very well. And then you have the watches, the screens are so small. I mean, like squinting. I mean, what we really need is like, you know, when you watch a movie at high-tech movies that you can press a button and then you get a projected screen in front of you? Like, no. Can you imagine? Like,
it's okay, Raven. We'll get you a smartwatch mascot. He will accompany you and you can see the time.
No, I need something like Star Trek. Like, you press it and then the projected screen, like, will come up to you. Like, you know, like Minority Report or something. Like, you know.
That's right. That's what I need. You should do that.
That's what I need, so I can see.
That's right.
Yeah. So you press and the thing... I mean, it's like, for what I see, I'm still squinting into the tiny watch. How can you see? Like, you just... I think we already breed a generation of people with very bad eyesight.
I actually wanted to bring this back to any watch developer, and that is, you know, if anyone is a fan of Public Enemy, you will know that one of their band members, Flavor Flav, actually wears a huge clock.
Yes!
Huge gold...
Yes!
A huge clock that's, like, you know, hanging on his gold chain. To all the smartwatch makers out there,
you got to make it big.
You just need to think about bringing the watch onto a gold chain, like this huge, you know.
Yeah.
You know, like a vintage watch, you know, the pocket watches that we all used to use in the 1800s. Can you think about doing something like that for all the blind people or the near blind people? Because, yeah, that would be really interesting. I don't mind buying a watch like that. So what?
I mean, it's hell of a night. Running out of fuel and all, you know.
Not too far off now. Keep talking. We'll soon be there.
Okay. Well, how about we talk and watch the latest trailer of Orphan Black Season 3 on my phone? Mm-hmm. It's back, guys! Yeah, so before we launch into the discussion, let's watch the trailer on my little smartphone here on Tomboy T-Rod. So let's watch the trailer now!
Trying awfully hard to save someone you tried to kill once.
But people took her for a reason, yeah?
You give me back Elena.
You're not in a position to make demands now, are you, Sarah?
What are we doing, Virginia?
It's what we have to.
You can't put them all under your wing.
They've got Elena. I have to try.
Stay the hell away from here.
We don't leave loose ends.
No, we don't.
If Elaine is an abomination, I'm much worse.
We can't rely on anybody but ourselves.
Just follow my lead.
How special you are.
You wanted this. All you had to do was stay away.
Orphan Black, the new season, premieres Saturday, April 18th at 9.
Wow.
So there's a lot of stuff I don't know about yet in there.
Wow. Let's put it in a nutshell for Raven. I think you know it's about cloning, right? It's about all the different clones that Sarah Manning is the original clone that we see in season one. Mm-hmm. And so she discovers that there's another girl. Mm-hmm. She arrives at some railway station, right? And then she discovers that there is another person that actually looks like her. Mm-hmm. And that person was killed. And then that's where the story goes. Like she stumbles upon other clones. One is a Russian. One was brought up in Russia and is like a lethal assassin. And then she discovers a geneticist.
Yeah, Kasima. She's like this hippie science nerd.
Yeah.
Free spirit.
Lesbian.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She's all over the place. And then there's Allison, the housewife, who's just so prim and proper.
And a drug addict. No, alcoholic, right?
Well, she's a little bit of both. She does pills and booze. She's an equal opportunity addict.
Exactly, equal opportunity addict. And so Sarah Manning, the original girl in the black leather jacket, like she discovers all these clones, right? And initially there's a bit of resistance because, you know, she doesn't know what the hell's going on. But then as the series goes along, they all kind of get together and try to find out answers as to how they all came about. And then they're all together. They're resisting other enemies. And it's really interesting.
Every time you think you know what's going on, all of a sudden, you know nothing. Everything has changed. And Tatiana Maslany is such a good actress that I have to constantly remind myself that it's the same person.
Yes.
Because you can tell who she is and who she's playing as soon as she's on the screen. And it's not just different hairstyles. It's mannerisms and the way that they act. I mean, Allison, I love because she's got these little noises and she's always like,
You know?
And then, like, Helena, whenever she eats, she's just so into eating. And there's all these different things. She's a fantastic actress, and she should have won all the awards.
And it's one of my points, you know, like, why didn't she win an Emmy already? Because she's just, I mean...
Because it's a sci-fi show, and because it's not on a main network, it's not getting the same attention. And because it's a sci-fi show, they don't take it seriously. But it's a really good show. And even though they don't actually say where it's set, it's totally set within an hour from here.
I know. It's set in Toronto, right? It's set in Canada, right?
Yep. It's basically in Toronto and the outlying areas. They go to the, like, where they go for where Allison lives is right outside of Toronto. And there's all sorts of communities like that. And then in season two, they go up into cabin country. And that's exactly where I live. So it's like, whoa. Although I don't live in a little cabin like that. I just happen to live not far from the cabin.
So you could be our roving reporter for Orphan Black then.
I totally could be. So I heard that my favorite actress from Lost Girl is going to be in Orphan Black season 3.
Really?
Yes. I can't remember the actress's name.
She's not in the trailer, right? She's not in the trailer.
No, she's not in the trailer. But the one that plays Kenzie, which is Beau's best friend and roommate. And I absolutely love her. What's her name? It's like really weird. It's like
Senia
Cassini,
Solo?
Cassini something. Yeah.
Senia Solo.
Yeah, yeah, that sounds right. Anyway, she's going to be in Orphan Black season 3.
Nice.
And I'm so excited because I couldn't finish Lost Girl. I really gave up on it. But I love that actress, so I was really excited to see her elsewhere.
I mean, what'd be interesting now is, okay, Raven,
now that they've
revealed all the female clones, right?
Mm.
It's another twist to the story. It's a gender twist to the story. So
yeah.
I still think that, you know, it's got nice pacing. It's got a really awesome actress helming so many different roles. And I'm just amazed. I can't imagine what her filming schedule is like.
Oh, it's got to be crazy. I did this thing last month where for a week I kept dressing as different characters every single day.
Oh, that's so cool.
And I did 3 Orphan Black characters. And the goal was to dress as the characters, but in regular attire, so like I could walk around. It wasn't cosplay because it was just clothing that I could go to the store and I could go to work.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was researching how to do Cosima's hair, and I found this blog of the makeup artist and every detail that goes into the wigs. And then I read how Tatiana has different music playlists that she listens to before she goes in and acts as one of the different clones.
Mm-hmm.
And she's gone so far as to have playlists set up for when she's playing one of the clones pretending to be one of the other clones. So she'll be Sarah pretending to be Allison, or Allison pretending to be Sarah.
Wow.
Or Helena pretending to be Sarah, which is always funny.
That's a whole new level to method acting, man. That is...
It's fantastic.
I mean, Tatiana has brought it to another level. I mean, it's not even method acting anymore. It's split personality acting.
I think she's very talented. Anyway, doing just the research for that, an interesting tidbit was... So when I was done with the Cosima hair and I took it out at the end of the night, the texture of my hair ended up being Helena hair. It was like all frizzy and all over the place, which is very strange for somebody like me who has pin straight hair. My hair does not curl.
But that's my next question. Did you put on the accent, like the Helena accent, the Russian accent, or did you put on the Sarah Manning
British accent? No, I didn't. I didn't exactly do that. No. Although it would have been fun had I ran into anybody who knew what I was doing or what Orphan Black was. But I did post pictures for there's a podcast called Clone Dance Party, and it's a bunch of newbies going episode by episode, watching it for the first time. So I posted in their Facebook group every single time, and everybody had really good comments.
I think that's interesting.
But the other thing that I really, really enjoy about Orphan Black is it's very female positive.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got some great, and it's not just Sarah or Cosima or any of the clones. I mean, they're all great female characters, fully developed and have everything going for them. But you've got Mrs. S, you've got Delphine, you've got even Angie. I mean, yeah. And then the other thing that I absolutely love, where Orphan Black got it and Dexter totally missed it, is family is not blood.
Mm-hmm.
And when you look at Sarah and her brother Felix,
right,
they are brother and sister, and they care about each other 100%.
More than if they were related through blood, right? Blood ties, right?
Yeah. And Felix feels that same connection to all of the other clones because they're his sister.
Mm-hmm.
They have his sister's face, so it's very easy for him to fall into that relationship with them. I mean, Allison is so completely different from Sarah. And yet Felix and Allison build this really strong bond right away.
Yeah.
And Felix, you know, is Uncle Felix to Kira, but I mean, really, he's somewhere between an uncle and a father to that child.
It's also good in the sense that with all these clones that Tatiana is playing, it actually plays up all the different female strengths.
Yeah.
And they don't downplay it. And that's what I like. It's like they don't have any negative thing about it. Everyone has their strength. And they use it to the best of their ability to get themselves out of a situation.
No, I have one question. this is a theory that I've heard, and I kind of like it. So the woman that jumps in front of the train, we're led to assume that that was Beth. What if it wasn't Beth?
Dun, dun, dun.
What if it was someone else pretending to be Beth, and Beth is still alive somewhere?
They might use that as a plot twister. Mm-hmm. Maybe in season 5 or 4.
Or 7.
Yeah. So Raven, it's time for you to get onto the show.
You need to watch it.
Also your show.
I don't know. I think I'm like, I have bad experience from Dollhouse, and after since then I'm like totally sway of Coons.
This is so much better than Dollhouse. And I liked Dollhouse. I feel like this is more akin to Dark Angel.
Yeah.
Than Dollhouse, you know?
Yeah.
And if you like Dark Angel, you'll probably really like this.
Yeah, it's this is like having like 3 bags of sugar all at once. So
Hi, I'm Nuke Chasp, the host of Nutty Bites.
And hi, I'm Tech, Nutty's regular guest.
Or antagonist. Our podcast is like a call-in show where geeks get to debate topics about speculative fiction.
You don't really debate.
Sure we do. We debate topics such as lame superpowers, the best villains, and our favorite apocalypses.
We're more of like rant, rave, and then have massive nerd rages.
People call in from all over the world, sometimes minor celebrities, and we've even had some supervillains show up.
Do you ever notice that you never have any superheroes or good guys?
I'm a good guy.
Compared to what?
Antagonist. Not really a guest. Nutty Bites. Nimlas.org.
Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Come on!
Yes! Do you ever get withdrawal symptoms from all that enthusiasm?
Well, not at the time.
Oh, shut up, Rafe. Oh, try to curb your enthusiasm, please. We don't have to look desperate or we'll give the game away. Tech Weapons Demolition Man there might just throw another weapon of mass destruction on us if these guys find out we're stealing their peanut butter trucks.
Oh, yeah. Whoops. Sorry.
Okay, here we are. Our storage facility. Careful there. Tech stores some dangerous prototype weapons in there.
Wow, you guys store weapons in there? Cool, what's this?
Peanut butter blasters. They contain peanut butter bullets laced with wasabi and spicy chili. It's a deadly combo.
And, what's this?
Oh, those are paintball peanut shooters. Great for weekend team building activities. We developed that 2 years ago for a company event. One of our guys got hit so badly in the butt, he couldn't sit for 3 weeks straight.
Okay. Okay. Hey, Raven, you grab the peanut blasters. I'll make one of these paintball shooters.
Help yourself to some organic peanut oil.
Whoa, you use peanut oil to run your delivery trucks?
Yeah, well, you know, we geeks believe in being organic.
Raven, this is a fresh kind of madness. Our trucks are never going to make it past 30 miles an hour with peanut oil.
Oh. Here, have a peanut. It's my special Nutty Bites flavored one.
Oh, nice. I'll take the whole bag, thanks.
Whoa, pretty big appetite, eh?
Yeah, you could really say that.
Hmm, you know what? Actually, this isn't too bad. A combo of spicy chili and wasabi. Oh, no, what the? Okay, and now we come to the part of the show where we do a little quiz. And because our guests are from a pretty nutty podcast, let's cap this episode off with a nutty quiz we like to call...
It's in a Nutshell.
And the first question of our quiz. Guys, hands on your nuts now. How many peanuts does it take to make a 12-ounce jar of peanut butter? Is it A, 540 peanuts, or is it B, 1,200 peanuts?
1,200 peanuts.
Raven?
540?
Well, it had to be one or the other, right? Raven, you're the winner!
Well, my 12-ounce jar is much denser in peanuts, so you get more of that peanut taste.
Great. So next time we buy Nutty Bites peanuts, it's going to be like the heaviest 12-ounce jar of peanut butter, right?
Yeah, I could probably break a head of it, yeah.
You'll both have to carry it, you know, one on each side.
Yeah.
Okay, are you guys ready for question number two? Okay, in 2013, how much million packs of peanuts did Delta Airlines purchase? Was it 70 million packs of peanuts or 20 million packs of peanuts?
I'm gonna go with 20 million.
No, Delta's a pretty nutty airline, maybe 70.
Okay, Raven wins it. It's 70 million packs of peanuts.
And they say the airline industry is going into the ground. Well, if they've got 70 million peanuts, obviously they've got plenty of customers.
Yeah, actually, you know what? If you get on their flight, you should be asking them to calculate your frequent flyer peanuts instead of your frequent flyer miles. Okay, question number three. Dun, dun, dun. How much did the peanut industry contribute to the USA economy every year? Is it A, $4 billion, or is it B, $6
billion? Wow.
Oh, let's go with $6 billion. I'm optimistic.
I didn't think that it would contribute so much money to the US economy.
I know, up to the billions, right?
Yeah, I was like thinking, okay, that's a lot of nuts. Maybe 4 billion.
Yeah, Raven is right again. 4 billion to the USA economy each year.
Oh, really? Yay!
Wow, Raven is on a peanut roll. Come on, Nutty Bites.
Yeah, woohoo!
Okay, question number four. How much do you think Americans spend each year on peanut butter? Is it $1 billion or is it $800 million a year?
All right, let's go with $1 billion. $1 billion with my finger in the corner of my mouth.
I actually think it would be $1 billion because Americans do eat a lot of peanuts a day.
You guys were close, but no cigar. Both of you are wrong this time. It's actually they spend like $800 million a year. Because you know why? You got to remember they also buy a lot of jelly. So it's 50-50, right? Yeah, so it's peanut butter and jellies. Okay, last question. This is going to be pretty tricky.
Okay.
In terms of churning out peanut butter, right? Okay. The world's largest peanut butter factory churns out at least 250,000 jars of peanut butter every day, or is it 500,000 jars of peanut butter?
I'm gonna go with the $250,000 or the 250,000 jars.
Okay.
I'm going to bet on 500,000 jars
because,
yeah, I still think they eat a lot of peanuts.
This time, Nutty Bites wins. It's 250,000 jars of the tasty treat every day.
Oh.
Well, hopefully it'll go up to 500,000 soon.
Probably.
So it looks like it's 3 points to Raven.
Yeah.
And oh no, 1 point to Nutty Bites.
I got a rock. Oh. You know you came this close. Close but no cigar.
Fueling the trucks up, you know, like get it tanks.
No problem. Guess you'll be on your merry way delivering our high quality peanut butter then.
Yeah,
well, it was nice talking to you guys. It's always great to meet new staff.
Hey, well, see you real soon, Nutty. We gotta go.
This is where the weapons
relax. They're here in the duffel bag.
I don't like this. This is too easy. She knows something.
Oh, who cares? Let's just go while we can. Okay, Nutty. Bye. See ya.
Bye.
Yeah, catch you on the Nutty Bites podcast. Power.
Oh, wait up. Aren't you forgetting something?
What?
This. Your IDs. Where are they? No Nutty Bites employee walks around here without them. Come on, out, you thieves.
Hit the gas, Mrs. Hit it!
I am, but it's peanut oil. It's not going anywhere. Shit. Get the blaster and shoot her. Here, Raven, catch.
Come back here, you thieves.
Oh my god, she's catching up on us. Come on, hurry up.
You're not getting away with this.
Oh, yes, we are. Catch us if you can.
What are you doing?
Making ourselves disappear. I sneaked this smoke bomb into our pocket. See?
No, no, no. That's not a smoke bomb. No, it's a grenade. I am never eating peanut butter again, that's for sure. Well, guys, that's the end of another explosive episode of Tomboy T-Rod. Thanks for listening, folks. If you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to subscribe to the show on iTunes and Stitcher and give us feedback. Give us feedback! We've also got a great website with everything you want to read about being a tomboy in today's world. Please go check it out at www.tomboy-tarts.com.
And if you just want to connect with us outside of the show, we are also on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Tumblr. Just type Tomboy Tarts.
And if you have any inquiries about advertising, collaborating, or appearing on this podcast, or being interviewed on our blog, drop us an email at tomboy.tarts@gmail.com.
We are everywhere.
Until the next 2 weeks, folks. Ciao.
And adios.
Amigos. Peanut butter all the way.
Yo.
Peanuts. Come get your peanuts!